stand. I think it's only fitting for a teacher to stand. And in Ethiopia, there is a saying that if you want to make a case, then you stand and present it. Okay? I want to make a case. And my case today is titled The Interface, Interfaces Between Children, Development, and the Future. And this lecture is going to focus on three important themes. The first one is that we're going to unpack some of the concepts, some of the concepts that we'll be using in this institute in the coming 2 weeks. And then I'll try and historicize the origin of development thinking. And then thirdly, I would like us to explore the parallel, the interface between economic development and child development, or the experience of growing up. So I'm going to start with the question of who are children? What is a child? When does childhood begin and ends? What is development? And how do we think and talk about the future? I think when we think of children and childhood, one of the things that comes to our mind is the biological age that we use. The age of a child can be understood in a number of ways. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child defines children as human beings below 18 years of age. So according to this understanding, a person who is 0 years old, 1 year old, 15 years old, and 18 years old are lumped together in one category of a child. And I think this conceptualization of children and childhood is problematic in a number of ways. And today we were talking at the breakfast table about the problematic ways in which this arbitrary age, or what we call the calendar age, poses in terms of thinking and talking about childhood in African contexts. I think to me, first, it homogenizes the diverse experiences of children. Children have different capacities and needs. If you look at the needs and experiences of children who are 5 years of age and who are 17 years of age, it's hugely different. And also, in many African societies, a child who is 17 years of age has a lot of experiences that is more akin to adulthood than a child who is very young. So in many ways, such conceptualization of childhood on the basis of biological or chronological age is the result of the exportation of a once localized Western construction of childhood. In many places in Africa, there are different types of cultural or social age. And this refers to the type of age that is connected to the fulfillment of expectations in relation to other stages of the life course. For example, this can be linked to the rites of passage. For example, a boy in many East African communities, if a boy is not circumcised, then in many East African societies, if a boy is not circumcised, then that is a very one impediment to a transition to adulthood. And also, the capacity of children to perform their social functioning is very pivotal, and it is a very important marker of maturity. In many West African societies, for example, in Ghana, your ability to establish a household, to become independent, is a marker of a marker between childhood and adulthood. There is also this concept of relational age, which is at work in many places in Africa. And I know in Ethiopia, children may not know their exact true biological age, but they know who is the elder or the younger in their families and communities. this type of age, this type of relational age is very important in terms of assigning roles and responsibilities, as well as in terms of claiming certain rights. And then there is a subjective age. This is a type of age that in many ways can vary depending upon how children see themselves, where they are, who they are relating to. For example, in the research that I've carried out in Ethiopia with working children, with street children in Addis Ababa, many children have multiple age thresholds. Street children, for example, have a legal age, which in many instances is lower than their true calendar age, because that is a way of protecting themselves, for example, if they come into conflict with law, into conflict with the police, so they present a younger age. That is their legal age. If they wanted to access to, for example, financial support from non-governmental organizations, they may also present an NGO age, right? So a type of age that is skewed to serve their own interests. So this is subjective age. So when we talk about children in childhood, it is not only the biological age that is very important. I think all these relational, social, subjective, and cultural age play a very important role. Now, how do we understand development? Now, development, like I tried to point out yesterday very briefly, is a hugely contested field. It's a hugely contested concept. It is defined as an inevitable social and economic process. It is seen as something that all communities desire to have, a desired endpoint for all societies. Development is also understood as interventions, set of interventions which are aimed at improving the life of people in poor countries. It is also seen in connection with the policies and practices of various actors of development promoted largely by Western dominated institutions for implementation in parts of the world which is characterized by relative economic poverty. So in many, many instances, development is seen as an economic process. And it is largely represented as something which is positive, right? As something which is good. But the policies, the premises, and the overall objectives, the overall goals of development have come under a lot of contestation in recent decades. And this is something that we will explore in this institute in a greater depth, looking into and connecting more fully with some of the intervention programs which are put in place in many African countries connected to, for example, social protection, connected to education, connected to supporting vulnerable population, vulnerable children, disadvantaged children, and so on and so forth. Now, when we talk about development, I think it is very important to make a conceptual distinction between, number one, development theories, number two, development strategies, and then thirdly, development ideologies. Now, when we talk about development theories, we're talking about a set of propositions, a set of ideas, which aim to explain to us how development had occurred in the past. Now we talk about the developmental state model, we talk about the welfare state, we talk about modernization theories. These are ideas which explain to us on how development had occurred in the past and how it should occur in the future, right? And then we have strategies which are practical paths to development which are pursued by actors of development. And these are international agencies, the state, non-governmental organizations, communities, it can also be individuals. Now, development has been scripted and rescripted, and a very classical example of development strategies is the Millennium Development Goals, which was adopted by the United Nations Assembly in 2000, which set out strategies about the kind of path that countries, developing countries in particular, need to pursue between the years of 2000 and 2015. And then the Millennium Development Goals have been rescripted as new, as fresh, in 2015, as Sustainable Development Goals. So these are development strategies that are that sort of chart the path, the way in which countries can pursue. And in many instances, these international conventions, these international agreements about development and on development tend to inform national policies, national strategies of development. And if you really look at the issue of education, for example, as a case in point, many African countries adopted the idea of universal primary education, compulsory education, after having ratified the Millennium Development Goal and the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, which were in many ways mainstreamed into national policies and legislations. And then we have development ideologies. When we talk about development ideologies, we are referring to the values which are incorporated in the goal and objectives of development. And these values are in many ways embedded in the social, economic, political, cultural, ethical, and even moral ideologies, ideas that actors of development have. Now, how do we measure development? Measuring development is one of the areas in which there is a lot of disagreements. Oftentimes, development is measured as an economic process from the viewpoint of income. For example, many governments and international organizations in their national statistics of poverty use the poverty line. They use the GNP per capita income, the average amount of money that a person earns in a given country. But this kind of defining poverty is problematic, again, on a number of accounts. Because in many ways it is a singular way of understanding development as just as a mere economic process, right? But development, we know, is a multifaceted and complex concept, particularly if you try and connect the idea of development with indigenous notions of what it is to develop, what it is to have a progress. And then you have another typology of development, which was developed by the United Nations Development Program, known as the Human Development Index. And I'm sure you're all familiar on how countries of the world are ranked annually in the UNDP Human Development Reports. Now, the idea behind the Human Development Index is to take into account some dimensions of human well-being, because there is a lot of criticism about how measures of development focus on only the economic aspect of it and tend to neglect other dimensions of social change. And it is a composite measure. It is a composite measure that tries to assess three important dimensions of development. The first dimension is life expectancy, right? Life expectancy is seen as a measure of the well-being of a population. The average number of years that a person expects to live in a given country is taken as one composite measure for the Human Development Index. And then the second one is a measure for knowledge, okay? That is measured through, it says here, the education index, and I would say it is a schooling index, because basically what the index consists of is the number of children who are enrolled in schools, both in the primary and secondary level, and the number of people who are able to read and write, the literacy rate. So it's basically a very narrow version of measuring knowledge, measuring education. And then a third composite measure that goes into the calculation of the Human Development Index is the GDP per capita income. So it is these three measures which are brought together in order to rank countries according to how they are faring, according to how they are doing in terms of development. And again, this is in many ways criticized as being narrow and Eurocentric. So one of the things that I would like us to think through and discuss in this institute is how does this idea of development relates to Africa, relates to indigenous forms of thinking and talking about development, about progress, about social change. How does it also influences its future? How does it also reflects in the future understanding of development? And when I say development, I'm referring to both child development as well as national development or economic development. So it is on the basis of those three composite measures that in many ways shape our imagination of the world, our imaginations of the different regions in the world. We have development regions according to UNDP, which are seen as high development, a high human development region, medium human development region, and a low human development region. And you see Africa, sub-Saharan Africa in particular, is either a medium human development or a low human development region. And for me, using this kind of development, ideas of development has its own consequences. Because in many ways, it creates into this false binary, false dichotomy of what regions are. And in the literature in development studies, there is a lot of debate about how the concepts that we use have its own consequences, have their own consequences. And we describe the world in largely dichotomous binary approaches. We have the core, periphery, we have the West and the rest of the world, and we have the first world and the third world. We have the developed world and the developing world. We have the global north and the global south. And a recent addition to the literature is a kind of conceptualizations which in my perspective is very helpful is a majority world, minority world conceptualization. Now, how do these concepts in development thinking emerge? And why do we have to be very careful when we use them? Because they have their own implications to our academic engagements. I will start with the core periphery, which in many ways this is connected to the idea of dependency, the idea of the Latin American school of thought, the dependencia theory, whereby Western countries developed because they were in a position to cream off resources, to exploit resources from the periphery. So the core is at the center. The periphery is at the margins. So the peripheries provide resources for the center so that the center can develop economically. And then there is this concept of developed or developing countries, which in many ways implies economic convergence, but it also glosses internally highly differentiated countries into just two categories, right? There are many countries which are found in between, within this category. So in many ways it glosses over the degree of mobilities where some countries can also transit very, very quickly. And then we have the first world and third world binary, which is the legacy of the Cold War. Is there something that I?
Yes, read on this one.
All right. All right. Is it better now? Okay. I might as well see.
It's okay. It's okay.
All right.
Yeah, yeah.
I just think that it is. I like to stand when I talk. All right. So the distinction which is made between first world and third world is in many ways connected to the legacy of the Cold War. By the Cold War, I'm referring to the ideological hostility that happened between the first world, the one which is led by the capitalist United States, and the second world, which right after the Second World War was led by the communist bloc. So it is a rivalry, it's an ideological hostility, a culture of suspicion that occurred between the first world and the second world. And then you have the many independent African countries in Africa, Asia, and Latin America, which were considered at that time as a residual world, as a third world, which were up for grabs for ideological allegiances. So this is in many ways, this terminology has in many ways became obsolete after the collapse of the Berlin Wall in 1989. And then we have the Global North and the Global South, which roughly represents the North-South divide in resources, in wealth. However, this is also a somehow problematic terminology, problematic conceptualization, because if you really look at the Global South, for example, within Global South, you have pockets of wealth, rich places, rich locations, rich individuals, which have a kind of life and lifestyle that is more akin to some places in the Global North. And within the Global North, you have also pockets of poverty, pockets of marginalization. So when you really think about the Global North and the Global South, it is really a very fragmented geography, right? So it's not a very precise way of delineating development processes. And then we have the majority world and the minority world binary. This in many ways challenges our conventional notion of thinking and talking about development in different parts of the world. In reality, the South, the poor, or the so-called third world is a majority world because it supports 80% of the world's population, right? And 136 out of 192 of the recognized countries in the world are also found in the South, in the poor, in the so-called the third world. So these are the majority world. The rest of the world is actually a minority world. So these are some of the ways in which we think and talk about development. I think when we use these terminologies, these terminologies didn't exist in a vacuum. They have their own histories. And when we use them, we have to be very careful because they have their own implications into the way we are thinking about development processes. Now, how do we make then a connection, a link between children, development, and the future? And I would like here to offer you two examples, two meta theories, I'd rather say, that have drawn out of development studies in childhood studies. In development studies, we have a modernization theory, which has its own premises and assumptions about how development should take place in Africa. And then we have in childhood studies a very powerful, influential theory from developmental psychology on human development more broadly, but also more specifically about child development. And then towards the end of my lecture, I'll try and piece together the interfaces, the connections between these two grand theories about national development and child development, and how we can engage with them and take these further. Now, when did this idea of modernization emerge? Because the idea of modernization is so pervasive in national plans of development that African countries have, that Africa need to modernize. The idea that development as an economic process that would ultimately bring Western standard of living to Africa emerged right after the Second World War in the so-called the Marshall Plan. And I have this very interesting quotation from President Truman at the time, the US president, in 1947, where he charted out how it is a duty for the West to bring development to the rest of the world, right? How it is a duty for the US to solve the problem, the economic problem and the disease that people in the third world experience. He said, "We must embark on a bold new program for making the benefits of our scientific advances and industrial progress available for improvement and growth of underdeveloped areas." So he thinks development is something that you can provide, that you can deliver. More than half of the people in the world are living in conditions approaching misery. Their food is inadequate. They are victims of disease. Their economic life is primitive and stagnant. So the way the lack of development is explained as a reason, as a justification for why providing development is necessary, right? Their poverty is a handicap and a threat both to them and to more prosperous areas. I believe that we should make available to peace-loving peoples the benefit of our store of technical knowledge in order to help them realize their aspiration for a better future. It's a very powerful Eurocentric message which is embedded in this, that people in the poorer parts of the world should be helped to have the aspiration to develop and to have a better life. So, when we talk about modernization as a theory, there are two fundamental features. The first feature of modernization is that of industrialization and urbanization. That there is a need for have a structural change in terms of the economic engagement, the employment of people. There is a need to move away from traditional agrarian primary economic activities to instead focus on more modern industrial and service offering sectors of the economy. That is one. Second is in relation to the geographical patterns of settlement, that people need to live in cities and in urban areas. So urbanization is seen as one core component or feature of modernization. So in many ways, the rates at which the people in African countries are urbanizing is seen as one indicator of modernization. That is the first one. And the second one, I think in many ways very vital to our engagement in this institute, is the ways in which modernization suggests this broader political, social, and technological change. And this manifests in a number of ways. First, it is related to the idea that there is a need to use rational, secular, and expert knowledge. And this happens often at the expense of other forms of knowledge, which to me are very important, but in many ways are kept to the side, are marginalized. Religious knowledge, the tacit local knowledge of people, children, families, and communities is not given a due emphasis, attention in national ideas of development, national ideas of modernization. The second dimension is the orientation of economic activities to meet the demands of the market, to meet the demands of the global economy. So instead of focusing on traditional subsistence agriculture or on fishing, for example, or hunting and gathering, which has been a way of life for many communities, particularly in the rural areas, modernization tend to pull societies away from that and then engages them with more so-called modern economic activities. And then thirdly, we have a tendency, and this was also something that we were talking about today at the breakfast table, that many of the problems that we face in Africa are actually connected to making everything that is informal and functioning very well too formal. Formalizing the informal, formalizing the informal education is at the core of the problem that we are going to explore in one of the sessions in the coming few days. Formalizing the informal economy is another aspect of the challenge that many African countries face today. Trying to formalize everything is at the core, for me, is at the core of the challenges. So modernization suggests that there is a need to accept the political authority of nation states rather than the authority which is embedded in local personal relationships. And that our construction of identity is built through messages that are transmitted to us by the mass media rather than, for example, through rituals, for example, through oral history, through oral tradition, which are very important ways of communicating, transmitting knowledge and experiences from one generation to the other. And this is still going on, continuing in many places in Africa. So there is this sense that modernization tended to erode the multifaceted, diverse ways in which traditional communities live and survive. So at the core of modernization, therefore, is a perception, a conceptualization that development has a beginning, it starts somewhere, and it has an end. So you have a continuum of societies and communities. According to modernization theory, all countries in the world could be found along a spectrum of continuum. And this is a model an American economist, Walter Rostow, in his book, The Stages of Economic Growth, a Non-Communist Manifesto. The title itself speaks it all. Whereby he theorizes as time passes on, countries pass through a well-defined stages of social and economic change. So at the one end of the continuum, you have traditional societies, and at the other end of the continuum, you have so-called modern societies, and in between, you have stages, right? Traditional societies composed of hunting and gathering, subsistence agriculture. You have the preconditions for takeoff, where, for example, advancement in agricultural revolution helps countries to become self-sufficient in terms of food, so they can focus more on a third stage of development, which according to him is the takeoff stage. He uses the metaphor of a plane that takes off in order to explain how development occurs, that traditional societies are there on the ground, and then the plane takes off, right? And then once the plane has arrived at a cruising altitude, that is what he calls the drive to maturity, or in other words, a stage where industrialization plays a very important role in the economic life of people. And then finally, you have the last stage, the stage where many of the current Western countries find themselves in, the stage of high mass consumption. So according to this model, economic development is seen as a series of stages, as a movement which was driven by investment in the productive sectors of the economy. So if traditional societies invest in terms of education, for example, or in terms of creating employment opportunities through manufacturing and industrialization, the idea is that they can catch up. They can catch up with the rest of the world. What do you think of modernization theory? Can it reduce childhood poverty, or can it improve children's well-being? And if so, how? I would like us to think about this, and then we will come back to it later on for discussion. All right? Modernization theory has been criticized as being Eurocentric because it suggests that all countries pass through these stages of development in the same sequential manner, and that northern countries are seen as historical models that southern countries have to emulate, right? But in reality, northern countries are competitors in development with the current southern countries. It is a unilinear model, implying that things get better over time. It assumes that the conditions for development or for the lack of it are only internal, and this is a problem because many countries in the global south, many African countries in particular, have been subjected to colonial rule. Their economies have been manipulated because of that. And for me, the fundamental problem with modernization is it is seen as a development model, but it isn't. It is an economic growth model, and there is a fundamental distinction, fundamental difference between development and economic growth. And then I would like to focus very briefly to some of the challenges that African countries face in relation to the economic model that they have pursued in 1980s and on, in 1980s and 1990s, which is connected to the so-called structural adjustment programs. How many of us are familiar with structural adjustment programs? I'm sure, yeah, we know. Yeah, structural adjustment programs is tied to the policies of international organizations, particularly to the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. Now, the history behind it, and I love history. I'm going to say a little bit about history because in everything that I talk about, because for me, in order to understand the lived experience of children today, and in order to have a fuller understanding of the aspirations that we have in the future, I think it is very necessary to connect to how their families and communities and nation states experienced growth and development in the past. And this, again, I will come back to it later, connects to my idea of what is known as the, in childhood studies, there is a debate between studying children as human beings in the here and now, focusing on the well-being of children today, rather than their future rather than the adult that they will become, because it is believed that focusing on the future distracts us from focusing from the lived experience of children at the present. But for me, there is also a third dimension. We can focus on the present, but I think the future is also important. But in order to have a fuller understanding of the being and the becoming child, I think we have to also see the historical child, the being child, as some scholars would like to suggest. Now, the history of structural adjustment programs is connected to the ideals of modernization, to the fear of the Cold War, because, and then thirdly, to the large sum of money that many oil producing countries have had in international banks. And this money was idle to be loaned out to third world countries who were very much keen on expanding in terms of like providing social services, education, school for their population. However, the borrowing failed to generate the expected economic growth. And at the same time, in 1970s and 80s, many African countries were experiencing a shrinking commodity market, the return that they would get from exporting raw materials to the global market was not that sufficient in order to pay the debts. So there were some concerns about debt defaulting, and some of the countries like Brazil, for example, suggested that they were not able to pay the huge interest that was accumulating in these banks. So many of the African countries also kind of believe that this is something that they would like to rethink, because there is this huge accumulation of debt that they are not in a position to pay. So the World Bank and the IMF, they suggested, okay, we can reschedule the debt for you, but under one circumstances of adjusting the economy, adjusting the national economy and the way in which it operates. So the set of suggestions come to be recognized as structural adjustment programs. And these consist of two dimensions. The first one is internal policy reforms. Many African countries, they were encouraged to increase the role of market in the domestic economy. And then secondly, they were also asked to undertake external policy reforms in order to encourage foreign direct investment and in order to increase exports. And this has a lot of manifestations in different parts of the continent. But if you really look at some of the adverse consequences of structural adjustment programs on the lives of children, it has been very, very dire. Because of structural adjustment programs, many governments pulled resources out of key areas which are very, very central for children's well-being and development, including, for example, food, including nutrition, including education, and so on and so forth. And this is a pictorial representation of the diverse ways in which structural adjustment programs impinged upon the lives of children. And we will come back to this. I will come back to this topic, to this issue, when I'm giving a lecture on laboring by African children, where I try to explain the hidden ways through which a crisis in social reproduction that is prompted by structural adjustment programs have impacted upon the working lives of children, the lives of particularly poor children in diverse contexts in Africa. Now, trying to establish a parallel between the meta theory of modernization on the one hand, and the meta theory which had been so fundamental in terms of shaping policies and interventions for children in Africa and elsewhere in the world, that of developmental psychology, particularly the theory which is espoused by Jean Piaget, right? Christ. Now, according to Jean Piaget, childhood is seen as a natural phenomenon. Childhood is seen not as a social phenomenon, but as a universal path of human development. Okay? And there is an emphasis which is placed on the cognitive development of the child rather than the social and religious and cultural development of the child. So children's maturation, according to Piaget, is an inevitable universal process. And according to him, child development is governed by a universal psychological and biological structures marked by fixed stages. And these stages are five: the sensory motor, the pre-operational thought, the intuitive thought, the concrete operations, and the formal operations. And there is, do you see a connection between the ways in which child development has been theorized and the ways in which economic development has been taught and discussed about, right? Now, each stages embodies a certain defining features and developmental expectations, and it builds on the accomplishment of the previous stage. Now, in modernization theory, for a takeoff stage to happen, countries have to go through the traditional stage. In order for countries to arrive at the stage of mass consumption, it's very necessary that they go through the rest of the stages that preceded them. In the same fashion, in developmental psychology, child development was seen as that temporally defined stage of progress. And if you don't successfully pass through the previous stage, then you are defined as what? As abnormal, right? And there is this very interesting parallel between child development and economic development that I would like us to dig deeper in the discussions. And similar to the modernization theory of economic development, Piaget's theory of child development is also very hierarchical, because it justifies, I mean, once children have developed and attained the stage of maturity and become adults, that is it, right? Adulthood is seen as superior than childhood. The stage of mass consumption is seen as superior than traditional societies, right? So there is this parallel that you see between these two models of thinking and talking about two developments. And I bring this because developmental psychology has played a lot of role. It has significant impact, particularly in education, in medicine, in the way children are fed, in the way their growth and development has been monitored, particularly in early childhood education and care. The role that developmental psychology has played has been very, very immense. Now, so what are the interfaces then? What are the parallels that I've been talking about? I'm trying to piece together. I'm drawing to you some of the connections that I see in childhood studies, in traditional ways of thinking and talking about children and children's lives, and in traditional ways of thinking and talking about economic development. The first interface is that there is a limited viewpoint on children and from children, both in national development and in the idea of child development. If you really look at development studies, the literature in development studies, it tended to have neglected the impact of development on children's lives. Whereas traditional ideas on childhood has neglected the role that children play, the immense role that children play in development processes. That is one of the interfaces that I'm trying to piece together. The second one is that in both child development and national development, there is a tendency to theorize development as one-directional, as a unilinear growth. Societies are seen as passing through well-defined stages. Child development is seen as a universal rather than a social phenomena. And the third one is both these theories say very little about the lived experience of children in the context of traditional theories in childhood studies, but also of societies and communities and families in Africa, right? For example, the dominant model of modernization